Welcome to our workshop today, Using Rubrics for Assessment. Assessment's a process of gathering data, and more specifically, assessment's the way that instructors gather data about their teaching and their students' learning. The data provides a picture of a range of activities using different forms of assessment, and that can include pretests, observations, examinations. And once that data is gathered, the instructor can then evaluate the data. Evaluation, on the other hand, then draws your judgment to determine the overall value of an outcome based on that assessment data that you looked at. So it's in the decision-making process then where we design ways to improve the students', potential gaps or deficiencies or weaknesses and address those in our teaching. I'm Amanda Smothers. I'm the Teaching and Learning Coordinator in the Center for Innovative Teaching and Learning. I earned my PhD in English from NIU in 2016, and I've been teaching college English for over 15 years. I teach a combination of face-to-face, hybrid, and online courses, and I teach students within a wide range of ages and experiences. I'm a big fan of rubrics. I use them for most of my assignments, and I find them very useful. So our objectives for this workshop are to define different types of rubrics, to look at the components of a rubric, discuss how to define an effective rubric, and then look at some examples of and resources for creating rubrics. So if you wanna post to the chat your name, your role, your division or department so that we can get to know each other. And we'll take a minute to do that. Great, thanks. Nicole is a graduate teaching assistant in biological sciences. And then we have finance too. So we've got two very different subject matters here today represented. And rubrics can be used for pretty much anything that we ask students to do that we want to assess. So we'll talk about that. So I just want you to take a minute to reflect on your experience with rubrics. Have you ever used rubrics when grading? Have you yourself been assessed using rubrics? How do you feel about using rubrics? What do you think are the benefits, challenges? What do you want to gain from this workshop? So you can touch on any of these questions. I'll give you a minute to think about and respond either in the chat, or if you want to unmute yourself, you can do that as well. Okay, so you may use rubrics made by an instructor of record to grade assignments, also made by that instructor. Had multiple classes that used rubrics to grade assignments. It was nice because it removed uncertainty, like a roadmap to success, absolutely. And you want to incorporate rubrics into a course you're designing, but don't feel confident in your ability to make rigorous, effective rubrics right now, hence why you're here today. Great, thanks for sharing that. and you want to learn how to use rubrics for discussion questions. All right, great. So there are some questions to consider as you prepare to assess student work. What are the attributes of quality performance on whatever the task is that you're using a rubric to assess? So in other words, which qualities or features would demonstrate whether students have produced an exemplary response to the task? What do you expect to see if this task is completed proficiently or just adequately or deficiently? Do you have any models of student work that exemplify the criteria that you will use to assess this task? Rubrics can help you answer some of these questions. So first of all, what is a rubric? A rubric is many things. It's an assessment tool. It's a systematic scoring guide. It's an instructional guide showing students how they'll be assessed. And it's also an explicit set of criteria that'll be used for assessing a specific type of work or performance. So this tells students, these are the things that you're going to be expected to be able to do, and these are the things I'm measuring within this task. What can rubrics accomplish? Rubrics can help us to set anchor points along a quality continuum so that we can set reasonable and appropriate expectations for students and consistently judge how well we met those expectations. So it's kind of a help for our students, but also it's a help for us so that we can remain consistent in our grading and set reasonable and appropriate expectations for our students. Rubrics also divide an assignment into its component parts. It helps us provide a detailed description of what constitutes acceptable and unacceptable levels of performance for each of those parts or criterion. And that shows who students how they can succeed on the assessment. So some of the potential benefits of rubrics include assessing complex and subjective criterion, evaluating performance, provide for precise, accurate judgment. It provides a common format for stating criteria and standards. It informs students of the criteria for success, particularly if we give them the grading rubric, you know, when we give them the assignment, which is recommended. And then it also documents and communicates our grading process. Some potential drawbacks, because it's not all roses. There are times when you might need to be subjective when assessing student performance outcomes or projects. So some potential drawbacks is that it may obscure subjectivity for ourselves too. So we might think we're being subjective, but we've also created this rubric. So it's not entirely objective either. We are subjective. So we're creating a rubric to try to be as objective as possible, but it's never gonna be 100% objective because we've created this rubric and we're also using the rubric to assess students' work. So the way that we use the rubric might be subjective as well. It could also drive instruction. So if we're teaching to the test, so to speak, we don't wanna just teach to the rubric. We wanna teach in a full way. So we wanna, you know, avoid the temptation maybe to just use a rubric to drive our instruction. It also might standardize how instructors think about student performance. You want to think about, are there multiple ways that a student could demonstrate that they've met certain criteria or objectives for an assessment, and make sure to account for that within your rubric so that we're not just standardizing how we think about their performance or how they can show us that they've demonstrated that they meet those objectives. And going kind of hand in hand with that, it might lead toward predictive performance, so, and could limit student creativity. If we're teaching to the rubric, our students might be doing their assessment to the rubric too. So they're, you know, yes, this is an outline for how to be successful in this assessment, but we don't want to receive all the same answers. Or all the same performance. So we want there to be enough nuance within the rubric to let our students flex their creative muscles when appropriate, and to not just give these formulaic prescriptive answers or outcomes. So there's checklists and rubrics, and there is a difference between the two. You might decide for certain tasks you want to use checklists. For some, you might want to use a full rubric. So a checklist has mostly yes or no absolutes. Something either gets checked off or doesn't. We might use this when we're introducing a basic skill or process. There's no judgment on the quality of the work. It's either just there or not any degree to which it's there, like there would be in the rubric. It also doesn't indicate student understanding or mastering of information or a skill, and it doesn't provide your detailed performance feedback. Rubrics, on the other hand, are a little bit more nuanced. They're not as black and white. They're used when assessing student learning. It evaluates the quality of students' work based on our criteria, indicates whether students have mastered that content, and it provides detailed feedback on their performance. And the level of detail in a rubric is really up to you. So one part of a rubric is descriptors, which I'll talk about. If you give, you know, thorough descriptors and you show your students how to use that information and how to use the rubric to understand why they got a certain score on an exam or on an essay assignment or on a discussion, then the effort that you put forth in creating those descriptors, which is a lot of work up front, will be worth it if students know how to use that information and you show them how to do that. There's multiple parts of a rubric. Each part's important, but it contributes to the whole rubric. Rubrics can be used to assess certain features of an oral presentation. It can be used to assess a written report, beginning, middle, and end, a musical performance, math problem solving, a case study, discussion questions. So here are the different components of a rubric. The task description, this involves the performance or the product or the outcome that students are being assessed on. The criterion, these are the traits, features, dimensions, quote unquote, slices of standards of excellence. And then we've got levels of performance. We want to label those levels of performance. We'll take a look at this, what this looks like in a second. We want at least two, but preferably more. You want to give yourself some flexibility. I try to do 3 to 4, any more than 5, and it gets to be very difficult to create those descriptors that differentiate between the different levels of performance. But any fewer than 3, for example, and it might be difficult to really give yourself the flexibility to work within that rubric and give students an appropriate grade. Descriptors are describing those levels for each criterion, and then the scores are the values that we use to rate each criterion, and then there's a weighting factor if applicable. You can have it weighted equally, so each criterion is worth the same amount within the overall grade for that assessment, or you can weight other, you know, certain criterion more heavily than others. So the weighting factor would give more value for one criterion than another criterion. So for example, in an essay assignment, I might give more value to content development and organization than I might give to, you know, grammar and mechanics, valuing the content over the polish maybe. But someone else might want to value those things equally. All right, so this is an excerpt from a rubric I've used to grade an essay assignment. And this particular essay rubric had 6 criteria: purpose, research, content development, organization, formatting, and mechanics. The criteria appear along the left column of the rubric, and these are the items, the criteria on which the students are going to be assessed. So I've got purpose and research in this excerpt. Those are my criterion. And then our levels of performance are going to appear across the top of the rubric. Those are the degrees to which our students have mastered the criteria. And you can customize what you call these levels of performance, but you might also want to include definitions of what you mean by those terms in a blurb somewhere on the rubric. And, you know, maybe somewhere in the course as well, if you're going to use the same terminology on all of your rubrics. So, for example, I might want to explain to my students that proficient means that the student has demonstrated an expert level of performance on the criterion, whereas competent means the student has demonstrated an acceptable but not superior level of performance. So I'm going to define these terms for my students so they know what this means. Otherwise, if they don't know what it means, then it's meaningless. The descriptors appear in the other boxes of the rubric. These are the descriptions of what student writing looks like under each criterion and for each level of performance. So you can see here in the sample rubric, I explain what student work should look like if it earned a proficient score for the research criterion. And that description is different than the descriptors for competent, developing, and novice levels of performance for research. There are pros and cons to writing lengthy and detailed descriptors. A pro would be that it may make grading easier and quicker because you could leave fewer comments, individualized comments. Before they've completed the assessment, those detailed descriptors also help communicate to our students what they need to do to earn their desired grade. So it may result in better student performance on the task as well. A con would be that it does take longer to write those detailed descriptors, but once you've written them, you may need to only tweak them from semester to semester rather than starting completely from scratch. And then also you might find that if your descriptors are too detailed and use absolutes like never or doesn't do this or doesn't do that, you might box yourself into grades that you don't feel are necessarily appropriate for given students' performance. So that's why I started using the word may throughout my rubrics. So they may do this, they may do that. And that creates a little bit more nuance with grading. And then I can leave comments that further explain the score to students when there's sort of that may or may not language in there. So I can clarify, okay, if we look here at my developing for purpose, may not provide an adequate explanation of the importance and relevance of the topic, may not adequately help the audience understand the different aspects of the topic, and or may not use relevant details and support in order to convey the writing purpose to readers. So if they don't do any of those things, then I might not need to clarify. But if they do provide an adequate explanation of the importance and relevance, but they don't do the other things, then I might say in a comment, hey, you did this well, but these other points aren't there, and this is how you could revise to meet expectations and get up to that competent level. The scores for each criterion and performance level can also be listed in the rubric. If you're creating a rubric using Blackboard's rubric tool, you'll have a few options for how you want to set up your rubric, and then those options will vary depending on whether you're using original course view or ultra course view. And starting in the spring of 2024, you will only have ultra course view to worry about. But we do have actually a separate workshop on interactive rubrics that addresses how to create a rubric on Blackboard. So I'm not going to go into that here, but if you are interested in creating, just kind of the nuts and bolts of creating rubrics on Blackboard, then definitely look for that, that workshop. And you'll also want to keep in mind that points values should be appropriate for each level and should emphasize the criteria that you want to prioritize over others. So for example, for me, research is more important to me when assessing students' essays than them setting up their essays using MLA formatting. So I'm going to assign formatting a lower weighted value than research. But that's not the case for all faculty. So, explaining these things to your students is really important. Explaining the weighting of different categories or criterion is important. And then just showing them how to read a rubric is going to be really essential to them getting a lot out of this way of assessing students. All right, so you might choose not to weight your grades and just assign points consistently based on the level of performance. So you could just use a single point value for each level of performance, as I've done here in this example, or you can use a points range, so 9 to 10 points for proficient versus 4 points for proficient. Whatever points values you use, I recommend taking some sample essays or assessments discussion boards or whatever from a previous iteration of your class and doing a test run of grading or assessing using the rubric just to make sure that it's working the way that you want to. What I've done in the past is I've created this rubric and I thought it worked out, and then I go to assess my students and I'm like, darn, those points don't work out the way that they should be working out. So just kind of do a test run, test this on some sample student work that you'll be assessing best if, you know, you've already assessed this work in the past. You kind of get a sense of, okay, this is working out the way that it should work out, and these points are, you know, working the way that I want them to with this assessment. You can also weight your grades instead of assigning point values. And that's easier using Blackboard rubrics because grades are automatically calculated for you as you click on those descriptor boxes while you're grading the assessments. So basically you can use point values to weight your grades, or you can use percentages like you see here. So the level of performance is 90 to 100%. And then I've got things weighted. Purpose is weighted at 10% of the overall grade for the assessment. Research is graded at 20%. And then it'll automatically calculate the grade for you. So when using percentages, all of the criteria percentages should add to 100%. So for this rubric, purpose is worth 10%, research is worth 20%. The other four criteria combined would have to total the other 70% of the assignment grade. And then the levels of performance should range from 0 to 100%, or 100% down to 0, as you see in this sample rubric. I like putting the proficient, or like the highest level, right next to, like, in the first column, so that's where students look first, particularly if I give this to students before they complete the assessment, because then what they're reading first is, what does a great example of this look like? What is the description of proficient work? Rather than reading, you know, what is the novice work? I want them to focus on, you know, what's the best quality. So these percentages tell us two things. One, what grade the student is going to receive on each criterion, and two, what level of performance the student has earned overall. So in other words, the student can earn a 90% for purpose, which means that she or he has performed at a proficient level for that criterion. And the way that that's factored into the overall grade is that 90% of that 10% of the criterion purpose comprises the whole assignment grade. The levels of performance can also tell students their overall performance level. So when you've got the same percentages set up across criteria, there's ways to individualize percentage or point ranges for each criterion as well, but that gets complicated. So if a student earns 88% on the entire assignment, then she or he or they have performed at a competent level overall, if that is not too confusing. So let's talk about next what a task analysis is. Task analysis is when you're breaking an assignment or a task into its unique components, aspects, dimensions. So you start with something that you want to assess, you consider what its features are, and then you determine how to represent those features in your rubric. So the rubric should address all aspects of the outcomes being measured and shouldn't address anything extraneous to those outcomes. So you want to tie all of the outcomes in your rubric, everything that you're assessing in the rubric, to specific course level outcomes and learning objectives. So for example, spelling and grammar might be considered extraneous on a science assignment unless you plan to measure an outcome that deals specifically with spelling and grammar for that assessment. For example, they need to spell a certain scientific term correctly. But if the assessment needs to address spelling and grammar in, for example, a composition class, first year composition, if that's something that's important to first year composition, and that is something that's being assessed at the course level, that's one of the course level objectives, then that would not be extraneous. And then you look at if the assessment needs to address critical thinking skills, does the rubric reflect that? Which of your course outcomes does the assignment address? And are those elements being assessed in the rubric? So we want to do a task analysis of, you know, what is this assessment? What are the things that I'm going to be assessing, the outcomes that I'm going to be assessing? and how do those tie into my course level objectives? All right, so death by criteria. A criterion is a feature that you want to measure to judge student performance. We should derive criteria from assignment prompts, from grading sheets, checklists, anything else that we've used to help students prepare for the assessment. But we want to keep the number of criteria manageable for us and for our students. Too many criteria might signal that the assignment is or assessment is trying to do too much. So it might be confusing for students. It'll be very time consuming for you to develop and use for grading. So we want to determine what exactly we want to assess, which again should be tied to our course objectives, and how we will assess it using this particular assignment. And then you can create an effective rubric. If you're trying to assess too many things, unless it's like, you know, a summative assessment at the very end of the semester where you're trying to assess all of the objectives, then, you know, you might be trying to do too much with one assignment. So take a look at that, make sure that it's manageable for you and for your students. So some ways that criteria may change based on the type of assessment being conducted. For an electronic presentation, we might be assessing for technical quality, for aesthetics or design, visuals, writing mechanics. For a written paper, we might be assessing on content, organization, thesis statement, writing conventions. And then for a musical performance, we might be judging or evaluating based on steadiness, breathing, appropriate instrument usage, interpretation, accuracy. So the type of assessment is going to really determine what kind of criterion we use to assess it. For levels of performance generally use adjectives to describe degrees of mastery. So for example, exemplary, proficient, competent, acceptable, satisfactory, developing, novice. Determine the number of levels that's necessary to assess distinctions of performance. Begin with fewer, and then you can always move to more if you really need to. The more labels on the rubric, the more difficult it is to differentiate between them and to articulate precisely why one student's work falls into the skill level that it does. So again, I recommend no more than 5 levels of performance. Even that I find to be a little bit much, depending on the task that students are asked to do. But start with fewer, move to more if you really need to. But also, if you start with too many and then you need to kind of cut it down a little bit, you'll notice that you'll need to cut it down when you're trying to distinguish between, you know, when you're writing your descriptors, between trying to describe what, you know, a competent is versus a proficient. So what is the difference between those two things? So if you start having difficulty with distinguishing between the different levels of performance in your descriptors, then that's kind of a clue that you need to cut down on the number of levels of performance. Labels may influence interpretations of the performance level. In addition to better communicating your expectations, those levels of performance allow you to more consistently and objectively distinguish between acceptable and unacceptable performance, or between exemplary, satisfactory, and novice performance when you're evaluating student work. And labels can be used with or without descriptors, but adding those descriptors can really cut down on the amount of written feedback that you need to provide. It can also be more helpful for students when they're trying to figure out what does that look like? What does expert look like with this particular criterion? What does competent look like? What does beginner look like? Labels can be used, it could also make it so that you need to clarify performance on criteria when a student's work doesn't quite match the descriptor precisely. But that's a little bit easier than having to write out all of your feedback. So that's one thing that you might have to do, is just clarify, okay, it doesn't quite fit that description 100%, but here's why it got that score and how it does fit. I recommend personalizing labels. You can personalize your labels as long as you explain what they mean, as I mentioned previously. So here's an example of that explanation using a table. You could also just write these out in sentence format if you prefer. You don't necessarily have to include this information with every rubric. So, you know, maybe you could just include it somewhere on Blackboard or in your syllabus's grading section, and just point students to that before, you know, they look at their grades, like, hey, remember, this is what exemplary means, this is what proficient means, this is what developing means, this is what novice means, and you can find that information in the syllabus or in X place in the course, particularly if you're going to be using the same terminology over and over again, which I do recommend. Descriptors. So descriptors, they spell out each level or gradation of performance for each of your criterion. They describe what performance at each level looks like. They tell students how the work will be assessed. It helps you distinguish between levels of student work. It can be omitted, but it does aid in activity when you describe it. Hello? Do you have a question? No? So they can be omitted, but they do help with that objectivity when they're designed well. Descriptors should contain at the very least a description of the highest level of performance in that dimension, and including only that highest. So for this sample that we've got on the screen here, it would be proficient, and that would be mean only providing a descriptor for that column, descriptors for that column. And doing that, it's called a scoring guide. And so essentially descriptors articulate what we mean by those labels for each criterion. Here's another example of a weighted rubric that hasn't been filled in yet with descriptors. So we've weighted the various dimensions according to their significance. And then we would add descriptors to identify what performance would look like in each criterion for each level. All right, so scores. How many points are needed to describe adequately the range of performance that you're seeking in student work? When you develop scores for your rubric, you want to ask yourself this question. So scores are just a system of numbers or values to rate your criterion. Scores can be quantitative, qualitative, a combination. You could consider a range of possible performance levels. Again, as I mentioned, I prefer placing the higher grade column first, and then we want to divide that into levels of performance. So a 5-point scale might imply, whether we mean to or not, A to F grading, and then that middle number might gravitate to the mean. We could use a separate scale for each criterion, which we talked about with the weighted grades. So make sure just to define what scores will align with the items on your rubric and associate points values or define what performance levels are based on that predetermined method of scoring. And think of the scores or the scale as sort of part of a continuum of quality in a way. There's different types of rubrics too. So a holistic rubric provides an overall assessment with a single scale of performance, and I will send you, those of you who are here today, I'll send you some examples of these in an email this afternoon. Analytic is the ones that I've shown you in these samples here today. So that assesses separate attributes, criteria, dimensions across performance levels. Task-specific measures one unique task, and then a general rubric measures criteria that are general across tasks. So holistic means to treat the whole rather than its parts. So a holistic rubric, in contrast to the analytic rubrics that I've shown you, doesn't list separate levels of performance for each criterion. Instead, it assigns a level of performance by assessing performance across multiple criteria as a whole. So usually they're best suited for simple projects or performances. They might give a quick snapshot or overview of the quality of the work. They could help you rate the entire project, activity, or performance. They provide a single score on all the criteria. So in other words, all the criteria are evaluated simultaneously. It combines all the important elements of the project or performance, and it's useful for summative or large scale assessment. Some considerations for this type of rubric are that there isn't an analysis of strengths and weaknesses. So you can't differentiate between, these separate criteria, and maybe having strengths in certain criteria and weaknesses in others. There's also not as much feedback to guide improvement, so it's not really useful for formative assessment. So here's an example for a bibliography. So we've got just an example, 1, 2, and 3 points awarded for this bibliography. So exemplary would mean we've listed 10 or more sources, included no historical inaccuracies, clearly indicated from which sources information was drawn, provided all relevant information, but they would get a 2, a competent, if they listed 5 to 9 sources, included few historical inaccuracies, indicated from which sources of information was drawn, but not clearly, provided the most relevant information. So you can see how, this might not provide students with as detailed of information as an analytic rubric might. So for example, what happens if a student has 5 to 9 sources, but no historical inaccuracies, and they do clearly indicate from where sources, which sources information was drawn, and they provide all of the relevant information. So that would probably still be a number 2. We would need to explain that to our students, and it doesn't allow us to parse out the different criterion and give them separate scores based on that. So this is the analytic rubric. Most rubrics tend to be analytic rubrics. And again, it articulates levels of performance for each criterion so that we can assess student performance on each of those criterion. So it's useful for complex performances, skills, or projects with multiple criteria or dimensions. We can judge specific criteria separately. We can give a separate score for each criterion, which helps with our weighting of scores. It reveals strengths and weaknesses in performance. We can use this for students to self-assess their understanding or performance. So I've done this before in my classes where I've given students the rubric and told them to grade themselves on, a draft of an essay, for example, and identify areas where they needed to improve based on the rubric. Using this type of rubric may take more time to score though, because we're gonna need to look sort of granularly at the student's task that they're being assessed on and look for different components of that at different times. So it may take a little bit longer to score using an analytic rubric than a holistic rubric. And then here's an example, again, an analytic rubric for a history report. So we could assess how well a student did on organization of the essay and distinguish that from how well the student performed on historical accuracy. And I definitely recommend using analytic rubrics as student performance increasingly varies across criterion. Analytic rubrics are helpful for essays, term papers, for example, or digital projects, scientific reports, those kinds of things where we really want to parse out the different criterion and assess for each one individually. Task-specific rubrics give detailed guidance for a single task. So it also provides for consistent scoring. It helps us identify what students know, facts, procedures, methods, equations, for example. It might be difficult to develop a new rubric for each task, though. And I'll send some examples of these, too. And then the general rubric. This might lead to standardized judgment where, a set of criteria are used for a broader assessment. So we might use the same rubric for multiple assessments. A general rubric can be used across similar performances or projects. So we might, have one rubric for all similar projects or presentations, for example. It helps students see the big picture. So how does all of this fit together? It also reduces development time because obviously developing one rubric is easier than developing multiple rubrics. But the cons might be that the feedback may be too general. And we may not want to assess students for the exact same things for each assessment as as well. So we might want to make that a little bit more nuanced and create separate ones. So developing a rubric, the first step is selecting an authentic task to assess. We want to identify ways that students can demonstrate they meet goals and objectives. We want to try to avoid inessential expectations and replicate meaningful tasks found in the real world and encourage students to problem solve and apply knowledge. We want to make sure that our rubric relates to the outcomes being measured, the course outcomes particularly. The rubric should address all aspects of those outcomes or objectives being measured. It shouldn't address anything extraneous again. Spelling and grammar may not be or may be considered extraneous on one assessment, but it might be considered essential on another assessment, regardless of the subject matter. Also, select a task that may be difficult to grade where you want to remove subjectivity. And the task will better assist students in understanding performance expectations. The second step is to determine our criteria. So we want to look for what are the criteria or what are the traits of the assignment that we want to assess. List all the details of the task. What do you want to assess or measure? Think about standards of excellence or competencies. Think about, and one place where you can look for criteria is in those objectives, those course objectives, and kind of break those down into more manageable bites. Chunk. So once we've got that list of things like components, we might want to group or chunk similar dimensions. So categorize those dimensions into criteria, limit the categories to a manageable list, and then add details with criteria categories. Our next step is to set our levels. So we want to identify our gradations of quality. Sometimes we might just use a numerical value instead of a label. So if you just want to use points instead of a label, you can do that. Again, differences between levels can be difficult to distinguish, especially as we add more and more levels of performance. So we want to identify the levels of performance for each criterion. We want to begin with fewer levels, as I've said. Distinguish between work that does or doesn't meet criteria. So what's the highest versus the lowest performance? Sometimes those are the easiest to figure out and to compare. But it's sometimes difficult to make those finer distinctions in the middle. So using words like never, sometimes, mostly might work, you know, to help us define those middle levels. And then we want to write our descriptors. So these are appropriate descriptions for each performance level, for each criterion. Describe what the performance looks like at each level. What's the depth, the breadth, the quality, the scope, the extent, the complexity, the degree, the accuracy, whatever is appropriate for that criterion. And include indicators for each level. So consistent, inconsistent, always, rarely, mostly. And then subsequent descriptions typically incorporate or echo the previous descriptions. This is also why I start with the highest level with writing my descriptors as well, because then I can kind of take away from that, okay, what might they be missing to get the level down? And then I can alter that descriptor so that it kind of matches what that might look like, and then go from there to the next level down. So getting that highest level descriptor is going to be the most time consuming, and then you can kind of figure out from there what each other level looks like. And then determining score values is going to be important as well. What's the maximum number of points for achieving the highest level of quality? And then we want to assign, you know, score values to each of the lower levels of quality. Those gradations should make sense mathematically, depending on the total number of points available, the number of criteria, and the number of performance levels. So this, you know, again, this is where you can create those points levels, kind of do a few checks to make sure that, you know, the math adds up, and then maybe use them to assess, you know, previous student work so you can practice and see where any issues might be before you start grading your students and before you start passing that rubric out to students. If you need to, you can also pass a rubric out to students before you grade their work that doesn't have any point values in it. So it just has the descriptors and it has the levels, but doesn't have any points values on it, so that you can, you know, make sure that it all works when you're grading, rather than having to be tied to those point values if it turns out that they don't make sense mathematically. Again, test and revise, try it out, compare an initial score without the rubric to one you would give with a rubric, or you could also review it with a colleague, have somebody else, you know, look it over, use it in class, describe it, just solicit student input prior to implementing it, and then revise based on that feedback. So some considerations when we're creating or selecting a rubric are, does the rubric align with our course outcomes or objectives? Does the rubric include performance levels? Do the criteria reflect current notions of excellence in our field? Are the scores well-defined? Is the rubric as fair and bias-free as possible? So we're humans, we all have implicit biases, but we can try to be as fair and bias-free as possible in our rubrics. Does the rubric allow for inter-rater reliability? So if someone else were to grade the exact same assessment using that rubric, would they get the same score as you, pretty much? And is the rubric useful, practical, and manageable? So some things that rubrics can do for you and your students: they can help function as an instructional and evaluation tool, so they can make sure we're keeping on track with our learning goals, facilitate timely feedback. So if it cuts down on the time that it takes for us to give feedback to students, then that's great because they get that information sooner and they can apply that to their learning and move forward. It can help us refine teaching by better organizing or defining our expectations. It can help facilitate communication between us and our students. It can prepare and guide students' work, and it can assess student work individually and as a whole. Some, you know, rubrics ultimately do help us promote meaningful assessment and evaluation when we use them effectively. Some resources that I'll share. I'll share some example rubrics. I'll give you some other handouts in my follow-up email, including value rubrics, which is Valid Assessment of Learning in Undergraduate Education from the Association of American Colleges and University. They've got different rubrics on different kinds of learning tasks, like information literacy. So I will give you that information in my follow-up email as well. And then here are some selected resources, and you'll get this list of resources too. And some rubric specific resources. And these are ones where you can find already created rubrics as well as build your own rubrics. Of course, I definitely recommend using the interactive rubrics on Blackboard if you're grading in Blackboard, because those are integrated into the gradebook on Blackboard. All right, so any questions before we finish off? Yes, Nicole.
First, thank you for this. I feel much better about my ability to make a rubric and use it in a meaningful way. Is there any way we could have our rubrics assessed? Are there resources out there, or is that something that the Center for Innovative Teaching and Learning could provide? Or do you recommend like seeking out our mentor?
Yeah, we can. I mean, if you have a mentor, definitely touch base with them. But you can also, you know, request us to look at it over in CITL. You can send it to me if you want, or you can send it to CITL in general through our help email address. And that'll go to, you know, whoever's the first person who's available to look at it, we'll look at it. So yeah, we can definitely do that for you. Take a look at your rubrics and see if we have any suggestions, but definitely if you have, you know, subject matter experts who are mentors within your department as well, they're a good resource too.
Okay. Thank you so much.
No problem. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you so much for attending today's workshop. And I will send that follow-up email to those of you who are live here today, which will include a link to this recording. Have a great week. And if you have any questions or think of anything, you can go ahead and contact me anytime. Thanks.